welcome to this conversation that I will have with Navid Nur, sitting on my right-hand side. I'd like to thank the Galerie Max Hetzler for hosting this event, and very happy that we can continue our conversation, yeah, which we have started a while ago. My name is Dominique van der Bogert. I'm an art critic from Amsterdam. And we engaged in a sort of conversation after I wrote a review of a show of Navid in Amsterdam for an English magazine called Art Review, because much to my surprise, Navid was exhibiting a series of paintings. He is known in the Netherlands as an artist who makes sculptures, conceptually based works, and only lately Navid is engaged in doing painting, and if I may say so, quite obsessively. He has made, over the past few years, several series of paintings, which are, some of them are here on display. Congratulations, Navid, because I think it really looks illuminating that you have selected from each of these series one or two prime examples. It wasn't really logical that you would do painting. I know you call yourself an artist, you don't call yourself a painter, right?
And no, not really. And I also don't want to paint. Because, yeah, it's just one thing before I start talking. I'm not made to talk, if you know, I'm made to make artworks. So this is like a limitation for me, that there are words coming out of my mouth, I have to make a sentence out of it so you understand what I'm talking about. Well, I make artworks, I don't talk. So therefore I'm here to try to talk to you, but don't take it too aggressively like a fact because he said like this. Maybe I meant it like a metaphor. I was talking about a carrot and a clown. So please just have that in the back of your mind. About painting. At a certain point, I felt like, is there a way how I do my own practice? Is to really try to see what's happening in between, which elements are missing within a space, how you can connect situations which are around what you want to put together. And this method, I try to push around the painting. So let's take this subject. I have it here. Okay, how can I look with the knowledge which I have built with the other works towards painting? And then this dialogue started.
Maybe it's nice if you can discuss some of the works in the show here.
Yeah.
And maybe we should start with the work which is part of a series of works you have painted with vitamins, Vitamine D.
Yeah.
You've made several of these works in several sizes.
Mm-hmm.
And they are abstract fields of kind of undefinable formations, mm-hmm, of splatters of paint. They are really grainy. You see specks in them. You see little streams in them. Maybe you can explain to us how you started with the idea of,
yeah,
choosing vitamin as,
yeah,
an ingredient for a painting.
Yes. So that series was one of the first ones, together with the kind of monochromes. So it was like this. When you go and stand in front of a painting, it doesn't matter which painting, you can pick any painting in your mind, you just stand in front of it. The only reason why you see the painting is because there's light between you and the painting. You shut off the light and there's no painting. Understand what I'm saying? So there is no painting. The reason why the painting is there is because you turn on the light. That's the only main reason. So I was like, if that's the case, that means that the first layer which is on top of the painting is the light between me and the painting. It's not the varnish or whatever you paint. No. The first layer between me and the painting is this light which hits the painting. And I was like, it's quite interesting how this light is so tremendously important while it's not part of the painting, like physically not part of the painting. It's like, how can I inject what is in between me and the painting to push it into the painting? How could you change light into a material which could be a pen. I, whoop, suddenly I was, when you have sunlight or light, it turns into vitamin D with your body. You produce vitamin D together. And vitamin D you can buy as supplements. So vitamin D is a kind of light as a material. You know, it's like a pill and it's an oil. The pill I can grind like old style painters do with their pigments to become more fine. I can mix it with the oil. Well, I have paint. I could work with it. I could paint with vitamin D. So therefore light is a material which I can use in the paper. So I bought from different brands, different vitamin D pills, different types of oils. So I had my palette, or how you call it, with colors. And then I wanted to make the painting. And by making, I meant like, because light moves around you, it scatters. I didn't feel like to have my own personal hand movement in the painting, because the moment you brush it, it is me doing it, you know? It's me using that material. And I was like, no. It's about this movement in between. So what I've done is I grinded different pills, it's a different way, just have a bit of binder, have different oils, and then just pour the painting full here and there, and just move the painting around, and then sprinkled it here and there. So
the canvas was on the floor.
Yeah, it was on the floor.
And so you had all these ingredients.
Exactly,
and you just threw them on the canvas.
Exactly, and I moved it a bit, and then they start to chemical react with each other.
Because what happened then?
Yeah, I don't know exactly what happened because I'm not a chemist, but they don't like each other, like as paint. It wasn't made to become paint. They just. And it really smells bad when you're working on it. And it turns really beautiful dark purple and a lot of pinks, a bit of yellow on the side.
All kinds of colors that you didn't foresee.
Nay, exactly. But then the next day, all those colors are gone because it's not the paint. So this painting really starts to evolve its skin constantly until at a certain moment, it will.
It'll dry up.
Yeah, it will dry up, yeah. And then I put it on the wall, and I was like, it's a painting. Yeah, I think so. I mean, it fits the tradition, so let's call it that way.
So you started this whole conversation about painting on a conceptual level.
Yeah.
So the question is, if light is so important for a picture, why isn't it part of the picture?
Yeah.
And you create it. Some sort of logic for yourself, which isn't maybe logical in any other sense.
No, but I think every artist has that type of logic. That's what you do. That's your job. That's what you have to do. To feel doubt, to feel like, am I? Yes, then you're doing okay.
Now, the work which is hanging opposite that work is totally different. A diptych made of little scratches, which you have found and copied and enlarged on canvas. This had a total different origin, right? This is an other concept.
In a way, it's true. It had a different origin, but the questioning, the method, how to work was quite parallel. And I was like, nothing is really spontaneous in the sense that it is always you doing it, even though you don't know what you're doing, but at the end you are doing it. So how much is it is free? There's no real free form. So then the question was, like the light, the matter and light question. It was more, is there a form, is there a shape which we produce as humans, which is free from, like really free, as in you don't know exactly what you do. Is there a certain kind of movement which is completely,
mark making, which is not intentional, you mean?
Something like that, yeah. Okay. That question, and I was like, hard one. I'm not sure if I could answer this one. And then, at a certain point, I saw these little scribblings. When you test a pen, I don't know if you go to a shop where you can buy pens, and you see those little pieces of paper where people just do. And you take another one. You know, you have all these little colors. So what is truly interesting about these pieces of paper is the following, that you have a pen, which is you, like which is you. Mm-hmm. And you are an identity. You have your own ideas, you have your own language. You have a reason why you're going to use this pen. Your handwriting is different than anybody else's handwriting. But that at that few seconds, you shut off this part in your brain of who is you. You shut off.
And when you scribble with a new pen.
Yeah, and then the moment, you first want to, it's more calibrating. You're calibrating your body, your inside of you, your identity, who you are with, the technical thing which you have in your hand. So this little scribble is still empty. It has this kind of calibrated moment, which is really short. And they're like little gems, you know, in this store. And I start to steal them everywhere. And then you have within your hand this kind of, what was interesting, that especially when I was in Japan, I had a lot from Japan. And they look exactly the same as the one which are from here. And by having all these little lines, you feel that in your studio there are thousands of identities like compressed into these little shapes, and that you as an artist can use that from your artist perspective to make a composition, to see where to put what, how your eye can move around the canvas, etc. Then I enlarge them and I just put them in such a organization. There's a small one also over there, which makes sense as a painting. And I feel that's a real free painting, in the sense that free, that none of the shapes are mine, but actually they are all so genuine, which gives the painting a certain kind of energy and temperature, which you will not find in any spontaneous painting done completely by one person. I can't prove this, but I feel it. Yeah, mm-hmm. So that's why.
Well, maybe we can come back to it later.
Yeah.
We should spend our thoughts now on a third group of work.
Yeah.
Which you call the marble paintings. I mean, or which you have marbled. They're not titled like that.
Yeah, they're untitled. Yeah, but they're marbled in a way. Yeah, but yeah.
But you had a particular fascination for this century-old technique of marbling, right?
What is interesting that marbling, because it's so colorful, it was always the mood giver to something on top of the marbling. So you have the marbling, and then on top of it is a piece of poetry or a piece of a holy text. And so the marbling itself never came to the surface as the thing to experience. Marbling, through all those centuries, it was the mood giver. It just gives mood. It was always silent. Silent as in it has this kind of energy and flow, and then it will be finished with the thing which is on top. So in this case, what made sense to bring it into a painting? Which material made sense, which has this mood feel, which could represent in the history of painting? And for me, it was gesso. Gesso, is it primer? Gesso?
Yeah.
It's the first layer. You have a linen, and then you put the gesso. So the gesso suggests that, I mean, contemporary, everybody just does whatever they want. But I mean, back then, the gesso, and still for some paints which I know, it represents your starting point.
It's the support structure for the paint,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, exactly. Make a support, it's your starting point, and then you let your idea move towards the painting. First you prepare it like a ritual. You stretch it, you put the gesso, and then when it's ready, you start to do the painting. And I was like, oh, that's so beautiful. So the gesso is always there. Not like, it could be like a mood, it's a starting point. And I was like, I should find a way to marble gesso.
So in order to find a solution for this problem, how to marble with gesso, with primer, you had to alter the material and you had to alter the technique. You had to reinvent.
Exactly.
But it's pretty amazing, the effect that you have reached with this technique of marbling. This huge optical wide fields of hairy movements.
So I can tell you about how I've done it a bit. Like, it was more like being a cook. So what you have is a foam, like a shaving cream, but a bit thicker, which doesn't react on a gesso. So you put gesso, swirl it on top, and then you move them both together, and they will never mix. you will just stretch the gesso more and more and more and more. And then at the moment, it's all white, so I don't really see what I do. You put the canvas in the gesso, and then you take it off. It's completely covered with foam. You put it on a wall, and then I needed to make a special wall for this work, which is super flat and smooth. You hang it, and then I needed to make another tool for this, so I can scrape all the foam off really careful. And the moment you do is the gesso will stay in the canvas, and the little lines, if you see Rincon nearby, those lines are so thin. They have such an energy, which you cannot reach with brush. That's what I like. You feel a kind of brush stroke which goes beyond in certain moments of this painting, and it gives such a new dimension and breath to brush strokes. It's amazing.
Before we move to the last series, the eye codex of the monochrome.
There's one with smoke.
First, we should maybe talk about that little work in the room over there, which is a small square canvas. In a kind of metallic purplish haze. That is actually not painted. You have not painted it with vitamin, nor with shaving foam, or with gesso. You have used a smoke torch in a rather unusual way. There is a little iPhone hanging next to the work, which is documenting about the process which you have organized to create these images. I can recommend you to have a look at what was going on, because it's quite amazing. Navid, what was the idea?
The original idea plan? was as follows. When you have how can I get a good starting point? Yeah, about the light, and then I come to smoke. So light hits a work, and if you see it from a scientific point of view, light are really small piece of particles, and they hit constantly. So in this room, they're like billions and billions of little balls hitting everywhere. And it was nice to feel light as a volume, which is hitting every corner each time. Well, we can't see it, but in a lab, you can see it. And I was like, hey, but there's something else also in this space. It's the air, it's the volume within the canvas and me. It's also the air. If there is no air, it's impossible. So that's also a part of the work, but that's then not really part of the work. Even if you have a room which is completely in vacuum, you can still see the work. So air doesn't relate directly to a painting. But what could be, what can I use air for? I could use air for to be the transporter. If you have pigments, which are really tiny, it will transport with air. It will move. It doesn't need a brush. It doesn't need me. It will just move around as long as it has air. And then what happens is it will hit the side of the gallery or the studio, and the architecture decides how the air is being bounced back and forth, and it will hit the wall. And if there's a canvas in front of that wall, it will paint the canvas slowly. So the air will do its work slowly. Like, boy, I should smoke a gallery. That was my first idea. So I had this idea for a long time, but many said no to me.
Surprisingly.
They didn't want me to smoke a gallery. So even here was not the case. So I had to look somewhere else, and luckily there are project spaces, small project spaces where they do more, not experimental, but there's possibilities. And I found one in Grenoble. It was a small project space. It used to be a garage. And then I was like, okay, let's go there and we will smoke the whole space fully. And then we will hang paintings in the space. We have smoke. I need to call smoke bombs for this.
So the torches were detected from a distance. Yeah. The room just filled with smoke.
Yeah.
The air was sort of crawling over the walls up to the ceiling.
Exactly, going down again. And they were painting
and
the paintings.
Everywhere there were canvases. Yeah,
exactly, they were painting the paintings. And all of them came out differently. It was so beautiful. It was such a mayhem mess. We had to clean for a week before the opening. But it was so, so beautiful. And that's why I really want to control this bit more. And now we are working on smoke wall paintings. This I could do in the gallery. I could do. Because you just have a wall which you completely seal with plastic foil and then have smoke bombs, which it's my own recipe, so they're a bit smaller. You put them in these different layers of foil. They go in between and they react with the foil and the wall. Between the foils, I made little cuts, so the smoke goes in between those cuts, and then like an aquarelle, it just moves together and you take off the foil, and then you have a wall painting.
So with most of these series of works, you try to stay out of the whole painting process, huh? Yeah. Leave it up to natural forces or chemical reactions or whatever, but yeah, not to your own handwriting.
Yeah, but I think it's important. At the end, you will die. You're not here. I mean, I'm here, but it's better not to have you in the works. The works need to do their own works. They do more work if you're not there. Mm. I believe so. You create a condition to make a work, then you take yourself out of it, and then it can stay. It's better.
Because that's actually what you have literally done with the iCodex series.
Yeah.
Which is based on the idea, what can we see if we close our eyes?
Yeah.
Now, if I close my eyes, I don't see much, to be honest. Just some darkness, some fake images, maybe after images of what you've seen just before. But you are quite specialized now in looking into nothingness. So
yeah,
maybe you can explain us about this iCodex series. What the
Yeah, that was one of the other ones that when you're looking at the painting on a wall, you know you can shut off the light and on to see it. Then you have the light as a vitamin who can be transformed, the light. Then you have the air around it, which you could move pigments around it. Then at the end is, if I just close my eyes, there is no painting. So that was the last step, and that was the most private one. Because by closing your eyes, of course you don't see the painting, but still you see something. There are two things happening here. One is you have what you see with your eyes closed. And by looking at what I see with my eyes closed, I was just each time putting some dots together, closing my eyes, what do I see, put those dots together. I had a bit more of these little pixels or dots, put them together on transparent sheets, and suddenly they start to move and do the work, which I also had the feeling which is happening when I have my eyes closed. I was like, yes.
An irregular grid of dots,
yeah,
and lines.
This is what I feel is happening in here as well. And the moment I had this piece of on a sheet, I was like, okay, I have it, but it's not a painting yet. If I would bring this back to a painting, I have to use colors. So then the question was, if I have my eyes closed, and there are not really colors, there are colors, but what should be beautiful if I could paint it with a color which is not a color.
And you found one. The type of green,
yeah,
used in the film industry.
Yeah,
and
to be cut out.
And the thing is, the cameras don't register the green.
Exactly, because it doesn't exist in
so
nature.
The color is invented,
yeah,
not
invented
to be not seen.
Exactly, it's invented not to be seen.
It's not available in nature,
no.
Only in the film industry.
It's a very young color, which I also like. It's a color which doesn't have a symbolism, or of course, it's a practical one, but it's not filled yet with all those, and I like the fact that it's a color which is not a color. It's a color, but it's not a color. You take it out. And that's chroma key, which you see over there. And the other one is also chroma key, the backdrop. So it is a color, but it's not a color. And then the top color, it's a more classic one. It's a primer. And if you come closer, there is also a purple happening in between those two, which is not there, which is nice. So it gives an extra dimension to it, which is not there. And we'll end that dimension changes where you show the work. So this lightning, it's a bit bluish white maybe, it looked completely different than in different lighting. It's constantly, yeah. Mm. At the end, it was worth doing it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Maybe we can hop to the other room for the last work, which is also part of the iCodex series.
Yeah.
But this time, you didn't use green paint or chroma key. You used the reflective foil.
Yeah.
Which people use in the industry to create, you know, signage for rope signing and stuff. Tell us a little bit more about that.
I like this road signing, road sign reflective foil, because it's also not really a color. The color happens only when your light is shining, then you see what it is, and or else you don't really see it, and still it has a stain of yellow. It's a bit yellowish, but then when the light hits it, you suddenly you will see what it is. Normally, it's in a space, and when the sun goes up and down, it completely illuminates and it comes dark again. And if you like, you can take also a flash photo with your phone, then you see it also quite nicely. It lives in between different conditions of light.
Because the yellow, in a way, is the opposite from that green. That green was developed not to be seen.
Yeah.
The yellow is developed to be utterly visible.
Yeah.
And it will be utmost visible when it's lighted frontally.
Yeah.
That's where the lamp
or
is there.
Or it's not there, yeah.
But the amazing thing is that each one of us who would make, with a cell phone, a picture of that work, will have a slightly different photo than anybody else, which is a bit scary for me personally, to know that the reproduction of the painting is unique, and that every reproduction of the painting is different.
Yeah.
And that the amount of possible variations is theoretically endless.
Yes, endless, yeah. Mm. Which is nice within these times where everybody takes photos, that this piece actually lives in your camera differently than others, and everybody can take some of it home in a way. So the piece is just a medium in between. Yeah.
Mm. Thanks very much. Thank you for your attention. We'll be hanging around here for a while, so feel free to approach Navid if you have more questions about the works. And thank you very much for joining us tonight.